We celebrate today in worship to the only true God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But who may appear in your presence, Heavenly Father, and who may call on you for help? O holy and righteous God, you alone make us clean. We have rebelled against you and become worthless. But your mercies never end. They are new every morning. At your command and trusting your promise, therefore, we come to you and confess our sins. Dear Lord God, because of our sin, Jesus had to be born. Because of our sin, Jesus willingly went to the cross. We accept responsibility for our sin and confess it to you. Assure us of the forgiveness we have from you, a forgiveness won for us on Good Friday and guaranteed for us on Easter Sunday. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends in Christ, forgiveness is yours. You are reconciled with God through Jesus Christ. As a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Almighty God, merciful Father, since you have wakened from death the shepherd of your sheep, grant us your Holy Spirit, that when we hear the voice of our shepherd, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The epistle lesson appointed for this Good Shepherd and Confirmation Sunday is recorded for us in the New Testament book of 1 Peter, reading from chapter 2, beginning at verse 19. In our reading, we hear that Jesus' resurrection means something to us, and by the Good Shepherd's wounds we are healed. For it is commendable if a man bears up against the pain of unjust suffering because he is conscious of God. But how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God. To this you are called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his footsteps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were like sheep gone astray, but now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Out of respect for the gospel, please stand. The Holy Gospel appointed for today is recorded for us in the Gospel of St. John, reading from chapter 10. In our reading, we hear how sheep listen to Jesus, the Good Shepherd's voice. Jesus said, "I tell you the truth, the man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate but climbs in by some other way is a thief and a robber. The man who enters by the gate is the shepherd of his sheep. The watchman opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought them out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice." Jesus used this figure of speech, but they did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, "I tell you the truth, I am the gate for the sheep. All who ever came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief only comes to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. We continue our worship with the hymn of the day, printed for you on page 7.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ. It is a long story, but about a month ago, I was accidentally invited to a cookout. And when my wife and I showed up, much to the surprise of the host, I ended up having a wonderful, wonderful conversation with the gentleman, the grill master, out back, about a business trip that he was going to be taking to tour a nuclear plant down in Arizona. That accidental Sunday afternoon, I learned more than I ever had before about plutonium rods and nuclear fission. I learned that there are some great positives to nuclear power, but there is that one great big radioactive negative. A couple weeks ago, you might have got the same email or the same mailing from We Energies. It was the opportunity for you to use clean power for electricity in your homes. It said that you could use 25% clean power for $5 extra a month, 50% clean energy for an extra $10 a month. That mailing was an aha moment to me that all this talk about clean energy is finally beginning to make its way into mainstream America. So, what should we choose? More windmills in Fond du Lac or more nuclear waste under a mountain in Nevada? I'm really not here this morning to encourage you to go nuclear any more than I am here to encourage you to go green or solar, because brothers and sisters, protons and photons can only do so much. Because there are millions of souls lost forever in the utter lights out of hell who left this earthly life with their gas tanks topped off and the lights of their homes burning brightly. It is the thought of eternal blackout that makes me eager this morning to plug you into the pure energy of Christ crucified and raised to life again. Because where else are you planning to go for energy that you need for living and dying? My brothers and sisters of this year's confirmation class, where are you going to plug in from this day until that day when you get to see the pure lights of heaven? We desperately need pure Easter energy. So, ready? Let Alfred Einstein worry about the protons and photons, and let Greenpeace worry about the windmills. As for you, brothers and sisters, don't you worry at all today. Instead, you rejoice today that pure Easter energy is all yours. Pure Easter energy has been driving and powering the church since the very day that the Christian church was born. There in Jerusalem, Peter is preaching a sermon in the city square on the great festival of Pentecost, and thousands of people have pulled up a pew to listen to what the Lord's apostle is proclaiming. And just before Peter winds it all up with an amen, he says this, it's in your bulletin. Let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, all whom the Lord our God will call." With many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them, "Save yourself from this corrupt generation." All those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. Peter's sermon pulsed with pure Easter energy. Now, for a moment, imagine with me that the lights are all out. There is no Easter. No, you can still keep your springtime festival. You can have your bunnies and your bonnets, and you can eat Cadbury eggs and marshmallow peeps until your teeth hurt. But there is no Easter, that Jesus, the Lord of life, is still rotting in a grave. Jesus, the light of the world, it's all lights out. And what are you left with? Well, Jesus would be one big fraud. And you would be believers in the ultimate hoax ever perpetrated upon mankind. The Christian faith would be living a lie. We would have no hope for living and only terror for dying. That, brothers and sisters, is the stuff that a nightmare is made out of. But we didn't come here this morning, did we, to imagine nightmares? Instead, we come together this morning to celebrate our dream come true, that Christ is not here. The tomb is exceedingly empty. He is raised again to life, just as he said. And that tomb, that empty tomb, radiates pure Easter energy, energy that is all yours this morning through the wires of the good news of Jesus Christ crucified and raised to life again. Easter energy is yours only in this way through the gospel, and it's always been that way. Think about it. How was it that 3,000 people came to believe in Jesus that first Pentecost day? Was it because of Peter's rock star personality? Or maybe it was, I know, because of the real slick Facebook page that the apostles had put together? Or maybe even they were going to be celebrating and serving Starbucks in a corner somewhere in Jerusalem as soon as church was done. None of that. 3,000 people came to believe in Jesus as their Savior because of a sermon that was preached that pulsed with Christ crucified and raised to life again. Pure Easter energy. But there was also another power in Peter's sermon that day. It was the power of God's law. How would you like to be standing in the sandals of someone there in Jerusalem when all of a sudden the preacher hits you with this? Let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Good Friday was only 50 days in their rearview mirrors. And they could all remember back to that Good Friday afternoon when they had taken the Barabbas option and screamed for Christ to be crucified. Every one of them could imagine that ugly thought of that afternoon when the crowds of Jerusalem became a lynch mob crying for the murder of Jesus. There they stood with blood on their hands and guilt in their hearts. What should they do about it? Lucky us, we weren't there 2,000 years ago taking the Barabbas option, were we? But brothers and sisters, our sin was certainly there 2,000 years ago. Our sin sharpened the nails. Our rebellion swung the hammer. Isaiah is spot on when he prophesied that he is pierced. Why? For our transgression. He was crushed for our iniquity. And Peter's voice still packs the punch today. God has made this Christ, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Here we sit, not in Jerusalem, but in downtown Waukesha. And blood is on our hands. What will we do about it? Maybe this morning we could pray it away. But do you honestly think that an extra Lord's Prayer or two is going to take care of every time that we put God number two on our life's list, or maybe way down from there? Maybe we could dig a little deeper and pay it away. I know we could give an extra $5 a week to the Raise the Roof appeal, but come to think of it, do you honestly think that a little extra in an offering envelope means anything to the one who owns the universe? I know we can try harder. Why, we can even come together in the Lord's house and make a promise that we are going to stick by him for the rest of our life. But do we really, really think, if it were all up to us, that a polyester white gown can cover up a lifetime of sin? Can it really? My hunch is we'd probably do it the good old American way, turn on the TV and tune out God's word, and then proceed not to worry about it. Brothers and sisters, stop trying to fix it. Instead, look to your good shepherd who's done it. The payment for your sin, it's all been made. The payment for our rebellion, it's been made. The justice of God has been served. The sacrifice that our sins required, it's been made on the altar of the cross, and your heavenly Father has accepted that sacrifice, and in his anger is perfectly appeased. Jesus' cross accomplished it. Jesus' resurrection proves it. And now he blesses you, brothers and sisters, with pure Easter energy. The resurrection of Jesus that has transformed our God and judge into our Father in heaven. The resurrection of Jesus that has transformed our stony, unbelieving hearts into temples of the Holy Spirit. The resurrection of Jesus Christ that has transformed slaves into sons and daughters of the Father in heaven through pure baptismal water. The people that day, they took Peter's sermon to the heart and were told this great truth, that 3,000 people that day became citizens of the heavenly kingdom through a sermon and through the water of baptism. And it's still that way today, isn't it? One sermon at a time, one catechism lesson at a time, one child at a time, one soul at a time, the pulse of Jesus' Easter energy still is alive and well in the Church of God today. Don't you think for 2 seconds that the glory days were back then and we're just kind of living here at the end of time? Poor us. Brothers and sisters, do you know that over 3,000 people worshiped Jesus just here at Trinity last Holy Week? Over 50 of them worshiped Jesus in the Spanish language here during Holy Week. I don't share those statistics to brag. That would be sin. I share those statistics to give you the picture that pure Easter energy is driving the church still today. The power of the resurrection brought 3,000 people from damnation to salvation back then. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is going to power 18 young people in this service to make their public proclamation of their faith in Christ Jesus. And that same worship, that same power of Jesus' resurrection that brought us to salvation is the very same pure energy that leads the saved to serve. Listen, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Verse 44, all the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all of the people. Enlightened with pure Easter energy. Do you notice what's on the top of the list? They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. The apostles were those hand-chosen men that lived with Jesus and learned from Jesus 24/7 for 3 years. They were witnesses of the truth. They were witnesses of Jesus' empty tomb. They preached and people listened. They taught and people learned. And still today, you, my brothers and sisters, in the front row are still proof that the apostles' teaching is alive and well in our day. Can any of you remember a time in your life when you didn't know the teaching of the apostles, who Jesus was, and what Jesus did for you? Brothers and sisters, my prayer is that Trinity and our Trinity family still pulses with pure Easter energy, that the teaching of the apostles always remains at the top of our life's list. That one day when we see Jesus in heaven, he would speak to us these words of revelation. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. Pulsing with pure Easter energy, the early Christians enjoyed fellowship with each other, and so do we. We're told that they worshiped together, they ate together, probably figs and olives instead of beans and brats, but they enjoyed time together as a family of believers. Think of this. There are billions of people on the face of this earth that can only take you further away from Jesus. Look around you this morning. Here is a family of believers that lives to bring you closer to Jesus. Or think of it this way, true or false? You will know and worship with this group of people in heaven forever and ever. True. Best advice, get to know and love each other this side of heaven. Pulsing with pure Easter energy, the early church broke bread together. That's a nice New Testament way of talking about Holy Communion, the Lord's Supper, that fantastic meal that Jesus gave to his disciples the night before he died. That meal was the early church's priority. And next Sunday, brothers and sisters, that meal is your privilege. Empowered by Jesus' resurrection, commune with your risen Lord often. He has his precious body and blood for you, together with forgiveness, life, and salvation. Empowered with pure Easter energy, be together in prayer. The early church was, for themselves, for others, praying to God on behalf of the world in which they lived. The early Christians knew that prayer was not some sort of Christian-flavored psychotherapy. In other words, Christian prayer is a privilege purchased by the death of Jesus, and it is heard because Jesus lives again. Brothers and sisters, pray for yourselves, for your families, for these confirmands before you, for the Church of God in the world, and for the world in which we live. And finally, powered by pure Easter energy, you notice that the early church joined together to help with each other's physical needs. We call it charity. Can you imagine a time when a Christian fell on hard times, that we actually hear there in the book of Acts that people in the church would sell their property to give it away and help with the needs of others? They were a generous people. Brothers and sisters, this morning you are seeing some very special fruits of your generosity. Before you sit 18 young brothers and sisters in Christ, and your generosity has provided for their Christian education and training. Some of that education and training was full-time, some of it is part-time, but all of it was costly. Powered with pure Easter energy, you provided for them, the next generation, this generation, through your regular gifts, through your wills and your plans, and through setting aside that tuition to make an education for the next generation a reality. All of it given not out of fear of the IRS. Every dime of it given because Jesus Christ lives again. Brothers and sisters, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is powerful stuff. It is pure Easter energy. It is God's power for our salvation, and it is God's power for our service. Peter preached that sermon. And once he said amen, 3,000 came to faith and were baptized that day. And in 1 minute, I am going to say amen. And then 18 of the baptized will make their confirmation vows here before the living Lord's altar. It is Jesus, the living Savior, brothers and sisters, who brought you to this day. It is the living Lord Jesus who richly blesses you this day. And it is the living Lord Jesus who will keep you each and every single day until that day when you will cash in those polyester robes of white for another white gown, a robe of heavenly glory. Amen. Please stand. And now the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. Two quick announcements this morning. Announcement number one for our Trinity family here. A reminder that our growth groups, our home-based social Bible study, began last week. We have 90 people enrolled in those home-based sessions for the next 4 weeks. You are invited to come along for the ride and enjoy that time together with your brothers and sisters in the faith. You heard me talk just now in the sermon about the Easter resurrection of Christ empowering the early church's fellowship. That's this. Secondly, this morning, an announcement to the voting members of Trinity Congregation here. We will have our call meeting, which has been in recess. That call meeting will meet again to staff our school tomorrow evening at about 7:30 downstairs in the fellowship hall. Once again, that call meeting for our school staff here will begin immediately following worship tomorrow night. Those are the announcements. Please do now take a moment with the friendship registers in each of the pews as we gather our weekly gifts of love to the Lord.
Thank you.
Please stand for prayer. Father in heaven, your mercies are new every morning, and you give your blessings to your people with much more than we need and much more than we deserve. You have given us the pure energy of your gospel message to create saving faith in our hearts and unite us through the resurrection of Jesus. Forgive us those times we've sinned against you. Restore us through the power of your holy word to find forgiveness only in the blood-stained cross and empty tomb of your Son, our Savior and Good Shepherd, Jesus. And help us to be patient, kind, helpful, and self-sacrificing to all people you bring into our lives this week. God of the family, we praise you for bringing couples together and bonding them together as husband and wife. We thank you on behalf of Bonnie and Ron Frederick, who are celebrating their 54th wedding anniversary, and Ron and Diane Walter, who are celebrating a 63rd wedding anniversary. Keep their hearts united in Christian love and commitment, and bless them with more time together. Help all husbands and wives to stay humble, kind, and helpful as they seek to give glory to your holy name. Great physician, we ask that you give healing to Gavin Pula, the nephew of Steve and Lisa Schuppler, who is hospitalized in ICU at Children's Hospital. Watch over Gavin and give skill and ability to his doctors and medical team. If it be according to your perfect plan, speed healing and recovery. Most importantly, send your Holy Spirit to their hearts to grant them peace if his suffering must linger. We ask this all in the name of the Good Shepherd, Jesus, who laid down his life for us. Amen. You may be seated. We continue our service as we sing together the hymn of invocation, hymn number 184, verses 1 and 3.
The confirmants, please stand. Brothers and sisters in Christ, our Lord Jesus said to his disciples, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I will be with you always to the very end of the age. In obedience to the Lord's command, you have been baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You have been taught the precious truths of the Christian faith as confessed by the Evangelical Lutheran Church. You know what God has given you by his grace and what he expects of you as his dear child. You now have the privilege of receiving the Lord's body and blood in the sacrament of Holy Communion. You are here to make public confession of your faith. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Romans, said, "If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Therefore, lift up your hearts to the God of all grace and joyfully answer these questions. Do you this day in the presence of God and this congregation acknowledge that in baptism God gave you forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation? Do you reject the devil along with his lies and empty promises? Do you believe in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit? Do you believe all the books of the Bible to be the inspired word of God? Do you believe that the teaching of the Evangelical Lutheran Church, as you have learned to know it from Luther's small catechism, is faithful and true to the word of God? Do you intend to continue steadfast in this teaching and endure all things, even death, rather than fall away from it? Do you intend faithfully to conform all your life to the teachings of God's word, to be faithful in the use of the word and sacrament, and in faith and action remain true to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit as long as you live? Since it is God alone who enables us both to will and to do his good pleasure, it is right for us, dear friends in Christ, to call on him for these confirmands, that he would graciously complete the good work which he began in them. Let us therefore bow our heads and pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for your great goodness in bringing these sons and daughters of yours to the knowledge of your Son, Jesus Christ, and in giving them both hearts to believe and mouths to confess his saving name. Enable them to bring forth the fruits of faith and to continue steadfast and victorious until the day comes when all who have fought the good fight of faith will receive the crown of righteousness. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, what we as a Christian congregation have here asked our Heavenly Father to confer on all of you, we now ask him to give each of you individually. The class may be seated.
Casey Nicholas Belsunas, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help you will remain faithful to him all of your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Casey, your confirmation verse. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. John 3:16. Casey, may the Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, renew and increase in you the gift of the Spirit to the strengthening of your faith, to your growth in grace, your patience in suffering, and to the blessed hope of eternal life. Stand as a communicant member of his church.
Anna Ruth Balgi, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him as all of your life? If so, answer, I do so promise. Your confirmation verse is, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is a stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Psalm 27, verse 3. May God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, give you his Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and knowledge, of grace and prayer, of power and strength, of sanctification and the fear of the Lord. Rise as a communicant member of his church.
Andrew James Borth, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all your life? If so, then please answer, I do so promise. Andrew, your confirmation verse, taken from the words of Deuteronomy chapter 11. Love the Lord your God, and keep his requirements, his decrees, and his laws, and his commands always. Andrew, may God, who began a good work in you, bring it to completion at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Stand as a communicant member of his church.
Benjamin David Richard Brown, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help you will remain faithful to him all of your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Benjamin, your confirmation verse, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Joshua 1. Benjamin, may God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, give you his Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and knowledge, of grace and prayer, of power and strength, of sanctification, and of the fear of God. Stand as a communicant member of his church.
Sydney Louise Butte-Time, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all of your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Your confirmation verse is Isaiah 54, verse 10. Though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace be removed, says the Lord, who has compassion on you. May God the Father who created you, may God the Son who redeemed you, and may God the Holy Spirit who sanctified you keep you faithful unto our life everlasting. Amen. Rise as a communicant member of his church.
Abigail Christine Fregeen, Do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all your life? If so, then please answer, I do so promise. Abby, your confirmation verse taken from the words of Isaiah chapter 41. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you by my righteous right hand. Abby, may God, who began a good work in you, bring it to completion at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Stand as a communicant member of his church.
Rachel Emily Gebhardt, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help you will remain faithful to him all of your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Rachel, your confirmation verse, he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. Rachel, may God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, give you his Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and knowledge, of grace and prayer, of power and strength, of sanctification and the fear of God. Stand as a communicant member of his church.
Emma Lynn Johnson, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all of your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Your confirmation verse is John 3, verses 14 and 15. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. May God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, give you his Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and knowledge, of grace and prayer, of power and strength, of sanctification and the fear of the Lord. Rise as a communicant member of his church.
Benjamin Michael Koenig, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Your confirmation verse taken from the words of Jeremiah chapter 29. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Benjamin, may God, who began a good work in you, bring it to completion at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Stand as a communicant member of God's church.
Daniel Matthew Lenhart, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? Do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all of your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Daniel, your confirmation verse, God is our refuge and our strength and ever-present help in trouble. Daniel, may God, the Father of our Lord Jesus, give you his Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and knowledge, of grace and prayer, of power and strength, of sanctification and the fear of God. Stand as a communicant member of his church.
Matthew Zachary Manzer, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all of your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Your confirmation verse is Isaiah chapter 40, verse 29. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. May God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, give you his Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and knowledge, of grace and prayer, of power and strength, of sanctification and the fear of the Lord. Rise as a communicant member of his church.
Andrew Thomas Miller, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior, and do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Andrew, your confirmation verse taken from the words of Jesus in John chapter 5. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Andrew, may God, who began a good work in you, bring it to completion at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Stand as a communicant member of his church.
Samuel Theodore Ortel, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all of your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Samuel, your confirmation verse, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Samuel, may God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, give you his Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and knowledge, of grace and prayer, of power and strength, of sanctification and the fear of God. Stand as a communicant member of his church.
Leah Charpino, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all of your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Your confirmation verse is 1 Samuel chapter 12, verse 24. But be sure to fear the Lord and serve him faithfully with all your heart. Consider what great things he has done for you. May God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, give you his Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and knowledge, of grace and prayer, of power and strength, of sanctification and the fear of the Lord. Rise as a communicant member of his church.
Abigail Louise Schaefer, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all your life? If so, then please answer, I do so promise. Abby, your confirmation verse is taken from the words of Jesus in John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Abby, may God, who began a good work in you, bring it to completion at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Stand as a communicant member of his church.
Jacob Anthony Spudet, do you, in the presence of God and of these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all of your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Jacob, your confirmation verse, indeed, the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Do not be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. I tell you, whoever acknowledges me before men, the Son of Man will also acknowledge him before the angels of God. Jacob, may God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, give you his Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and knowledge, of grace and prayer, of power and strength, of sanctification and the fear of God. Stand as a communicant member of his church.
Zachary James Wagner. Do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you will remain faithful to him all of your life? If so, please answer, I do so promise. Your confirmation verse is Joshua chapter 1, verse 9. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. May God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, give you his Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and knowledge, of grace and prayer, of power and strength, of sanctification and the fear of the Lord. Rise as a communicant member of his church.
Trey Myron Wisner, do you, in the presence of God and these witnesses, confess your faith in Jesus as your Savior? And do you solemnly promise before God that with his help, you remain faithful to him all your life? If so, then please answer, I do so promise. Your confirmation verse taken from the words of St. Paul in Romans chapter 8. I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Trey, may God, who began a good work in you, bring it to completion until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Stand as a communicant member of his church.
Your church now invites you to receive the sacrament of the Lord's body and blood. Accept this invitation with deep reverence and holy joy. Regard your communing at the Lord's table as a precious privilege given to you by God through his church. Receive this sacrament and thankfully and often. The Almighty, the most merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and keep you. Amen.
Amen.